ELT in Sri Lanka issues and the way forward. As Madam said very rightly, this has been actually written about almost 10 years ago. So some things have changed. Actually, I have changed the foreword, and it says where this the ELT, the whole domain of ELT has changed and where it has not changed. So if you read the book, you will understand better, actually. So what I thought of, since Madam, thank you, spoke about the book basically and what is in that and the other issues stemming from the book, I thought, let me look at ELT in Sri Lanka, issues and the way forward. And now, what are the issues? Let's just look at the issues basically. Most of the things Madam said, but I'm just repeating. A large majority of our students are unable to use English effectively after having studied English over 10 years during school career. And when they come to the university also, it's very pathetic, because I am with the least proficiency group at the university, arts faculty. And arts faculty, we take in usually about 800 students every year, of which nearly 500 belongs to the lowest proficiency category, scoring marks at the entry point of placement is scoring marks between 0 to 35. And there are students who score even 0 marks and who have problems with differentiating between capital P and simple P. So I don't think British Council gets this crowd, basically. But this is the reality. And if I talk about the bell curve, usual bell curve of our, you know, any test results, for English, it's not valid. For English, the average and the genius would be on both sides, minority, and the large majority belongs to that poor category. This being the case over maybe 60 years, 50 years. Oh, we are on the decline. That is the other sad thing. We are on the decline. So what are the issues? Employability issues are there. The failures we identify. Employability issues are there. Motivational issues are there. Confidence issues. A major thing that actually I'm working on that book next. My next book is on basically on confidence building issue. And that is on post-colonial curriculum practices in South Asia, building confidence to speak English, which is going to be out like by the end of this year. So then another issue is teacher training programs that are very ineffective for various reasons. There are so many reasons, but I'm just giving you the label only. Because the quota that has been taken, the quota system for colleges of education have changed. Those days when we were doing A-levels, those who could not get into the universities by lacking one mark would get into colleges of education. Now the system has changed so much so that the intake itself is not capable of handling the stuff that is being taught. So, and then teacher training colleges are always under criticism for various reasons. And then teacher quality as a result is declining pathetically. And if you, now we train teachers, various programs, ongoing programs, we have at university level, we conduct diplomas for teachers, this, that, all. But, and then even colleges of education, they have 2 years of teacher, training program, and then they go into schools, internship and all. The moment they go out of the orbit of that training, they lose complete touch with the language. And they start teaching in mother tongue. It's a translation. It's not even translation, actually. And then the other thing is, even if you train, the very scary thing is that, actually, my husband and I undertook a project in school, and then we were teaching confidence building program and training the teachers every week to teach in that program. It's a very specific program. And you cannot teach that in that program unless you are properly trained. What happened? I trained them, went around observation to see some teachers teach in the confidence building program some of the lessons as listening, reading comprehension. So teachers' mentality cannot be broken because it's same same stereotypical way of explaining everything. So these are major issues, and teachers cannot speak English. Most of the teachers, I'm sorry to say, most of the teachers can't speak English well now. School teachers, if you go into the rural areas, you would see teachers who are unable to speak 1 minute in English. So these are our realities. And then lack of monitoring in-service teacher training programs. There are now almost zero in-service teacher training program. Madam says there are, but if you ask some of the teachers in very rural areas, and how many teacher training programs, in-service teacher training programs do you have? Almost none, once a term, something like that. Maybe in urban areas, might happen in a little more frequent manner, but no, not overall, no. Lack of quality teacher educators. Madam, thank you very much for being one of my teacher educators. You taught us so well. And then Madam Vijita Yatavata, I must remember here, role models for us. But now, present generation of teachers do not have that luck to have quality teacher educators. I think we were the last who were blessed with that. And in every way, the way they delivered their content, the way they dressed, the way they talked, everything was ideal, and you were our role models. Thank you, madam. And lack of the other issue, which I am going to take up after this, is lack of coherent, tightly knit curriculum designs. As I realized, today's major problem in English language teaching in Sri Lanka is this. There's no tightly knit curriculum designs. I do not agree that post-method pedagogy or eclectic approach is suitable to Sri Lanka. Of course, teachers should be given autonomy, provided they are given the proper knowledge. Proper scientific knowledge after a rigorous period of study, formally tested, then they should be given the autonomy, not before that. The moment you say eclectic, okay, what is the approach you are using? You just interview 10 teachers, they would say eclectic approach, communicative approach, and then you would cross-check it. This is there in my actual thesis also. I interviewed teachers, university teachers also, that they would say eclectic approach. Okay, then I would ask, okay, what consists of this eclecticism? Communicative approach, then what else? Cooperative language learning, what else? That's it, but communicative language learning itself has cooperative language learning in. Cooperative language learning itself has communicative language. I mean, part of communicative language learning is cooperative language also. So you see, people don't understand. The other thing is that if you ask the other question, what is the teaching methodology you use? Communicative language teaching. Okay. Then cross-check. Okay, how do you teach grammar? Oh, I first give the rule and then give them the exercise. This is not communicative. This is grammar, direct method. Or kind of even a structural method, because it's a traditional way of teaching grammar. But the point why I'm trying to make is that our teachers are not aware of what all the methods and approaches that were in the past. If you ask what is Suggestopedia, heard of but do not know. So how would you create this eclecticism without being aware of what the methods and approaches are that were discarded for various reasons? That is one thing. And post-method pedagogy is another thing. These are very good ideal concepts, but they do not suit Sri Lanka for various reasons. Inequal distribution of knowledge, facilities, everything. I'm not going into much details, but we lack tightly knit curriculum or curricula. We need it. So I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Then lack of knowledge about teaching methods and methodologies, I too just mentioned. And the other issue is, even though I put it last, attitudinal issue. That's one major problem in this country, attitudinal issues. coming from the society into the language classroom and affecting our students' language learning. At the same time, going from the classroom into the outer society and then making them not speak and lose confidence. That's one major issue, not only in Sri Lanka, as we found out, it's plaguing the whole South Asia, Pakistan, Bangladesh, India. We were conducting research for the past 5-6 months going around this region, and we find very interesting results. We are waiting to, you know, put forth that in the next book, but this confidence issue, attitude issue coming from the society is a major problem in this country. So we need to address that also. Okay, so what do we mean by curriculum design? I'm taking up that point, tightly knit curriculum or curricula. So, and in an ideal situation, curriculum design means what? There has to be a needs analysis and goal setting, intended learning outcomes, material development, teaching methods and methodologies, assessments, and course evaluation, pre, whilst, and post. Why I said in ideal situation, in an ideal situation is because most of the time we don't do needs analysis. We assume our students' needs as their needs, but which might not be their actual needs. But we trust too much in our maybe experience, that's basically an assumption, because needs are different. Students' needs are very different. So we try to cater to, a commonly identified, commonly perceived needs. And goal setting, actually, because of this different World Bank projects and all, we put, you know, most of the stuff we thought we put them into a kind of, you know, a proper design, proper way, which yes, true. Compared to the time that I was doing the research, actually it was more or less scattered, I would say, but we put them into some kind of order, and these ILOs are very clearly defined, goals are defined, all that is there, and assessment also, it's not completely the final marks only at the end of the semester, but we have continuous assessments and all. They also have, actually we need to work on those also. But and then the other one, material development, that also we do. And teaching methods, methodologies, we do not define most of the time in the universities. We just say eclectic approach, okay, anything that you like, up to the teacher to decide, depending on the student you have to decide. Yes, that's what we mostly do. And assessments, 60%, university level, 60% of marks would be on this final paper, and the others are continuous assessment and all. School level, no. And then last thing, course evaluation, actually. Pre, whilst, we do not do most of the time. Pre-evaluation, whilst evaluation is the best evaluation. Whilst evaluation is the best evaluation, while the course is going on, the courses should be evaluated, but it doesn't happen. So therefore, it's not that organized, it's not that very ideal. Okay, so is that all there is to it? Even if it happens in the ideal way, goal setting, ILO, setting ILOs, material development, and all that is in the list, but I find it is not all. There has to be some more in this Sri Lankan context. There has to be linkages between and among courses and curricula. And there should be different types of linkages. There should be different types of binding factors going from one stage to another at every level. One is theoretical. Theoretical level, actually, I did not put that there, actually. So what kind of theoretical linkages we should have? We need to have theory of language, of language learning, of learning, theories of psychology, theories of literature, theories of speech functions, theories of needs, like Maslow's theory. There should be linkages within and between and among courses in terms of theoretical perspectives which are not conflicting with each other. And now, for instance, Dinali is here, I'm very thankful. When I set a conference, I submitted an abstract on using Derrida's deconstruction theory to teach English. Actually, this was not initially viewed as something, how could you teach English language using Derrida's theory? I was so surprised. Dinali, when I sent the abstract for the conference to present a paper, she said, "Asantha, this is good for a plenary, plenary session. Would you please do that?" So I was so happy that somebody saw this, what is in this. You see, so actually now our narrative-based curriculum in the Columbia University is based on that, basically. Because you need to find different theories to run along the line of this English language teaching curricula. The other one is, now, language learning theories, theories of psychology, we need, actually these are there. You would say, yeah, teaching methodologies have been influenced by theories of psychology all throughout, yes, but how many of us know about it? Do we teach this to our students under TESOL programs? Do we teach? Now we teach, I was very adamant with Shivani. I told Shivani, we must not only teach methodology, we have to teach educational psychology also, because these two go hand in hand. And most of our graduates who are into English literature and come to the languages departments are not aware of this combination, sadly. And we get actually MAs and MPhil and all, we have different components, but I'm not talking about that alone. Then the other line is, other linkage is thematic. We need to have thematic linkages between and among courses. Some of the themes are like themes of confidence, theme of cross-cultural competence, theme of national harmony, theme of subject knowledge, theme of social self-respect. Now, some might say, of course, these are there. We include all this, so, you know, ethnic harmony, cross-cultural competence, everything is there. We have goals, we have set goals, we have everything there. But there are no linkages, is my point. You need to reinforce all that. You need to repeat them. And one instance I would give you, one example. I go to edit teacher's guide by the National Institute of Education, A-level, and later I withdrew completely. I said, don't put our names even, because what happened, they have very clear goals set, national harmony, ethnic harmony, students should be able to achieve all that. And then there is one paragraph about knives. You see, knives. And knives are useful for this. But you see, when you do not establish linkages thematically and all, why do we need knives there? Of course, there could be, if it is a cookery lesson or something. But the point is that we lose track. We lose track when we do not have thematic linkages established, re-established. So we need to have thematic linkages in terms of, now for instance, confidence building program. I'll show you one or two examples of how to establish these linkages through courses, between and among. Then, content-wise, of course, we try to achieve some kind of linkages, for instance, grammar items. So we teach, at one level, we'll teach grammar items. Next level, we'll teach some other grammar items. Like that, we will increase difficulty levels and all. So in terms of that, we are trying to achieve, but I don't think we always have a very good coherent pattern of, introducing content-wise linkages also. Then structural linkages should also be there. For instance, for different levels, difficulty levels, there should be structurally, you know, that also we do more or less. And then communicative potential development, cognitive potential development, scales to measure activities, you know, little by little going up, and then the next course, whether they have achieved that, then we go to the next level, and there should be linkages. So what is very important is this theoretical level linkages, the thematic level linkages, so that we do not lose track of what we want to do. So then passages like knives from nowhere would come in. Because what we do, most of our teachers, we download material and then copy paste and we change, we say, we nativize it, we make it, we adapt. But what we do is, John went to London, Siddipala goes to Colombo, you know, or Siddipala went to Colombo most of the time. So, and in the absence of this, what happens is we lose the grip of the tightly knit curricula. So this is very important that we need to look at the whole thing as a whole at different level from different layers. Then example curriculum design for a theoretical linkages. I have taken Jim Cummings' Big Sand, Cups and Caps theory. So it goes from, it rises from level to level, from one course to the other, like that. You see, BICS, basic interpersonal communication skills, you develop and you use CUPS, common underlying proficiency skills, for the next course, and for the next one you use CALP writing skills, and the next CALP speaking skill, cognitive academic proficiency skills. So this is one example. There are so many now. Deconstruction theory is another example. And then example curriculum design, thematic linkages. Now I was talking about this confidence issue. Now with one course, confidence building, speaking, you have confidence building theme. And then you go into the next one, narrative-based course, speaking and writing, you develop confidence. And then you go into the next one, confidence maintenance. So this is thematic flow, thematic linkages that we need to think of. And then internal structure of a curriculum or course. Now, for instance, confidence-building course, internal structure, it has speech act theory gone into the materials design. It has a very specific teaching methodology, cooperative language teaching associated. So you can't teach it using eclectic approach. So, and then assessment is definitely a stage play. Nothing written, nothing listening. You see, this kind of thing, so very specifically designed to achieve a very specific objective. And we are not trying to achieve here language proficiency. It is to build students' confidence to learn English, upon which, once you build it, you can project that confidence to learn English also. So for that, you need to design a different curriculum or different course. Now, for instance, internal structure of the narrative-based curriculum. You see, material, principles of reconstruction theory by Derrida, and teaching methodology, eclectic, but you have to clearly define what this eclecticism means. What methods, what approaches have gone into, and train the teachers accordingly. And then assessment is retelling a story, either in written form or spoken form. So we talk about constructive alignment, you know, to match all what we test, what we teach and test. So all that should be there. Then, now that is specifically about curriculum or curricula in English language teaching and how we should make this a tightly knit curriculum or curricula or ELT domain. But need to approach ELT from different angles at the same time is very important. So I'm talking about, the first one is attitudinal change. Has to be there. Now, for instance, Speak English Our Way did a very good job in relation to change in the attitudes of the society of English language speaking, basically. And the state support was there. Instead of Kadua, there was a Mannaya. Things were, but there were problems with that. Problems was that as I understand, that the people, the personnel selected to do the task was not properly qualified. So that was a problem, but you have to, this attitudinal change is very important, and state support is required for that. The other thing is professional pre-training. And I am proposing a degree in ELT curriculum design per se. Only in that, and I'm going into much details about that. The next thing is we need to monitor at the same time proper in-service teacher training programs, not just to train them, but to check whether teachers are able to speak in English in a coherent manner for about 5 minutes. And we need to monitor that. And then at the same time, evaluation and changes. So we run a course, we look at it from a very empirical perspective, and then we need to change depending on the requirement. And at the same time, needs also change, student needs. So we need to change all that. And so this is my proposal. Actually, exactly 7 years ago, 2011, May 26th, I submitted a proposal to the Ministry of, University Grants Commission. And I found that proposal just before I came here, and it is, actually nobody has made use of it. Professor Rohan Rajapaksha, at the time, UGC Vice Chair, told me, Asantha, get you administrative support, I will give you 21 million rupees to do this. Proposal for training the trainers, training the university English language lecturers to train the school language, English language teachers in Sri Lanka. 2011, May 26th. And it is still with me, and I'm still struggling to do something, but nobody listens. Through this, I propose this. And I was so surprised that after I wrote all this, then I thought, okay, let me find that proposal, long time ago. And I called Professor Rohan Rajapaksha, and he remembered that. He said, Asantha, we lost power, so we couldn't do, but then you couldn't get it done also from your end. That was the main problem, actually, sadly. So I propose 4-year degree course in ELT curriculum design only, not TESOL. Not any other MA in linguistics, nothing, just ELT curriculum design, a special cadre of professionals we have to have, and they must have in the first year knowledge, a thorough knowledge of principles of education, philosophy of education, educational psychology, teaching methods and approaches, not just fragmented knowledge. They have to have the historical background of all this, how this developed, psychology, field of psychology, how it developed, how it evolved, how did it influence principles of education, how did it influence philosophy of education, how do they involve helping each other, enriching each other. We have to give this knowledge to our students at least for 1 year. It's not just one semester or 1 month or 10-hour course, no. Thank you, madam. You all taught us this for 3 years. And the second and third years, we have to talk about essential components of curriculum design with the links that I was talking about established. Because then only our students will be able to understand. If they have that background knowledge, thorough knowledge of the philosophy of education and everything, they will be able to get into essential components and why we do it. That this is what I learned from this research. And then the other one is the final year internship and research, especially on curriculum design. Dr. Lalita Ananda, I know you are a very progressive head of department, and I hope you will take this up. And we also have chance at Colombo if we make use of. But going by my experience with working with Dr. Lalit, he always incorporates when I suggested something. He said, yes, Asantha, we'll do it. So somewhere we have to start in the private sector, Rushira. because we can't discriminate in our private sector, public sector, because every output is going to the society. So we have to make the maximum use of it rather than blaming. Okay, so that is my proposal. That is what I propose. No tussle, no in between. We have to produce a very knowledgeable, highly knowledgeable cadre of professionals in the ELT curriculum design is the only way out. If we started this in 2011, now we are running the second course. We could have run the second course. And actually Bangladesh is inviting us to do this, maybe Pakistan also, but not Sri Lanka. Sad. But without which, we have no way out, because post-method pedagogy won't work here. Eclectic method won't work here, because our teachers should be given the thorough knowledge first. And we have to create cadre of teachers. And then this has to be, the other thing, university-based. Because we have a huge attitudinal problem in the society, and we can't break all that in one go. We have to use that. So using a university, we have to give this course. Actually, through this I propose, what I propose is we had at the time 25 on the permanent staff. As soon as I came back, I thought we should divide into, get into five groups. 1 year, we educate ourselves in five groups, curriculum design. 1 year, the ELTU staff, I'm finishing, ELTU staff will get ourselves educated. Then we will advertise it. And the UGC agreed to get the teachers released for 2 years. Dr. Rohan Rajapaksha said, yes, Asantha, I'll try to do that. You see, so you need that also. So, this is not just one person's game. One person can't do that. We need everybody. So now, private sector from Malambe, Dr. Attanayake is here too. So, whosoever is going to do it, please do it. Think about the next 10 years. And I thought, and nobody supported me. Sad. But I'm still struggling. And my dear students from Jayawardenepura University, take it up. Thank you.